So let's take a look at some equivalent exposures, and I'm just going to put some examples here in this box that you see down below. And I want you to note the shutter speeds. I've got them listed above along with the f-stops or the aperture settings. So you can use this to follow along with. So for an example, let's say that we have 1/60th of a second at F11. Okay, 1/60th of a second at F11. And I want to go now to 1/250th of a second. Then if I do that, what will my F number have to be? What is the F stop going to be if I go from 1/60th to 1/250th of a second? Okay, let's take a quick look at that. If I am at 1/60th of a second at F11, and now I'm going to change and go to 1/250th of a second, what is happening here? All right, let's take a look at what's happening. I am going from 1/60th to 1/250th of a second. That means that I'm going to a faster shutter speed because the 1/250th is a faster shutter speed than 1/60th. But how much faster is it? Okay, it is 4 times faster because if I go from 1/60th to 1/125th, that's doubling the time. And then if I go from 1/60th to 1/250th, that's 4 times as fast. All right, so what I'm going to have to do to the f-stop is go the other direction and open up to allow more light to come through. When I'm at 1/60th of a second and I go to 1/250th of a second, the amount of time that light is allowed to strike the CMOS chip on your computer is cut down by 1/4 because of the faster shutter speed. So this means that I need to allow 4 times the amount of light to come through than it did at F11. So to do that, from F11 to F5.6 allows 4 times the amount of light to pass through the lens. So this would be equal then, so I could actually say 1/60th of a second at F11 equals 1/250th at F5.6. Okay? F5.6. Just remember what you do with one, the shutter speed in this case, you have to do with the other, which is the aperture. So we're making the shutter go faster, less time is allowed for the light to strike the CMOS chip. We're going to compensate by allowing more light to come through the lens by opening up the aperture to f-stops, in this case, from F11 to F5.6. We are opening up 2 stops, 1, 2, which again is 4 times the amount of light. Okay? Let's take a look at another one. All right, let's say that I have 1/500th of a second at, let's say at F2.8. All right, 1/500th of a second at 2.8, and I want to now, let's say I'm photographing at a river. And I want to do that water shot that you saw a while back in the other video. All right, to do that, I have to use a slower shutter speed and put my camera on a tripod. And so to get that to happen, let's say that I want to use 1/8th of a second for my shutter speed. All right, what is my f-stop going to be then if I change my shutter from 1/500th down to 1/8th of a second? All right, so again, let's take a look at what's going on here. We are at 1/500th of a second, and we are at F2.8. All right, So now we are going to go to 1/8 of a second. Let's see how many shutter speeds slower that shutter is going to be. 500 to a 50 to a 250th is 1, to a 125th is 2, a 60th is 3, a 30th is 4, a 15th is 5, and an 1/8 of a second is 6 times, in other words, 6 shutter speeds slower than what we started out with. Okay, so now we are going to end up wanting to use an 1/8 of a second. So we're just going to, now keep in mind, the shutter is open a lot longer at an 1/8 of a second than it would be at a 500th, even though we're talking about fractions of seconds. We're still talking about a slower shutter speed, allowing the amount of time that that shutter can remain open. Because the shutter is going to remain open for a lengthy period of time, we need to cut down on the amount of light passing through the lens by the same amount. Okay, so we will do that by going from a 2/8 to a 1/4 is 1, 2 to a 5/6, there's 3 at f/8, 4 at f/11, 5 at f/16, and 6 at f/22. So what we could say then is that if I change from an 1/8 of a second, then I need to use f/22 for the aperture so that both of these exposures are equal. Now let's take a look at what would happen here. So the answer here is actually going to be f/22, okay? So a 500th at f/2.8 equals 1/8 of a second at f/22. Now, the difference between these two photographs is that this one, if the river, the water, will be stop action. Okay, stop action here. And the photograph at 1/8 at f/22 will definitely now show the motion. Will show the motion of whatever is moving the photograph, in this case being the water. Also, if you'll note here that we have quite a difference between the aperture settings. Here's f/2.8, here is f/22. This photograph here is going to have what's called greater depth of field. Okay, greater, I'll just say D of F, greater depth of field. And we're going to talk more about depth of field here again in just a minute. But remembering back on the slides that I showed you of the animals from Africa, how the background was blurred. Well, they would be blurred. The background would be blurred more in this example here, where like the photograph of the sunflower and the mountain that you saw in the background, that would be more of what would happen with f/22 in this example here. So just keep these things in mind, and as you photograph, and like I say, the more you do it and the more you think about it, the more it'll come to you very, very quickly. All right, let's look at one more. If I'm photographing, let's say if I'm photographing at 1/125th of a second, okay, at f/4, all right, we'll just make the little at sign here, at f/4, and I want to show motion of running water. We'll use the running water example again. What should I do? All right, we know that 1/125th of a second is not going to show that cloudiness or that cotton-like appearance of the water because the shutter is too fast. Okay, so I need to slow the shutter down because the longer the shutter speed, the more that motion of the water is going to record like that cotton appearance that you see. So knowing that it takes a fairly slow shutter speed, let's just say that I want to use a half a second, because I know at a half a second I'll get that. Well, if I'm at a half of a second, then what is going to be the aperture setting that I will end up using to make the exposure so that it is equal and so that I'm not over or underexposing this particular photograph? Okay. Now, and something else we'd have to keep in mind here is that from going from 1/125th of a second to a half, I'm going to have to put my camera on a tripod, because I cannot hand-hold a half a second exposure and keep the non-moving thing sharp. So let's take a look at what we've got going on here. All right, we have 1/125th of a second, and we have f4. All right, that's the first example that we have. And then I've decided now that I want to use a half of a second exposure, but in doing so, I'm going to have to close my lens down and to see that if I can close it down enough to keep my exposures accurate. So let's say my lens has the full range of f-stops here between f2 and f32. Let's see what happens. All right, I'm at 1/125th at f4, and I've gone to a half a second. So again, I've gone, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I've gone 6 shutter speeds slower. Okay, keeping in mind that, again, the slower the shutter speed, the longer the shutter's open. And so I have to cut down the amount of light. And knowing that you close down a lens by going to a larger F number, less light will come through the lens. So again, we said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We've got to close that lens down 6 stops. So that'd be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I would have to use F32 to keep these exposures equal. And I would be able now to have that blurriness of the water, because I would be able to use a half of a second. Sometimes the range of your f-stops on your lens won't allow you to go as slow as you would like, and this is where then you might want to change the ISO setting of your camera so that you can, when you change the ISO of your camera, you can change the sensitivity of the CMOS chip so that you can take a better advantage of the aperture range or the shutter speed range that you have on your particular camera. All right, let's just look at one more here. All right, so the question I want to pose, and think about this for a moment, all right, does a 30th of a second at f16, okay, does a 30th of it at a 30th of a second at f16 using a 100 ISO film, does that equal 1/125th of a second at f16? Notice that the apertures are still the same, with a 400 ISO film. All right, now keeping in mind what I spoke about a little while ago about ISOs, remember that the higher the ISO, it allows you to go shutter speeds faster, or it allows you to close the lens down more. So let's take a look at this and see what's going on here. We've got a 30th of a second at f16 with 100 ISO. So the only thing that's changing in this example then is the shutter speed. Notice the shutter has changed from a 30th to a 1/125th, and the aperture has remained the same, this one being at f16, and this, of course, remaining at f16. Well, if what I said was true a while ago, let's throw in, remember we said ISOs double each other? Well, what would happen then if I take the 100 and double it to 200? what would that exposure be? Okay, so let's say we put in there a 200 ISO, then we would say for that, that we would be able to photograph with a 200 ISO at 1/60th of a second at f16, right? So if that's true, then a 400 ISO would equal 1/125th of a second at f16 because that's the next shutter speed faster. You just keep in mind, when we looked at this, a 30th, here's the 30th at f16, and then for a 200, that would take us up to a 60th at f16, and then the next one would be a 1/125th of a second at f16 as well. So what we could say here is that the 30th of at f16 was 100 ISO. The 60th of a second would be equivalent to changing your film speed to 200 ISO. And 1/125th of a second would be equivalent then of changing your film speed to 400 ISO. All right, all of these exposures are equal because now I'm changing the film speed to gain what I may or may not be able to do with my shutter speed and f-stop. Okay, I hope you were able to follow this and understand what we're talking about with equivalent exposure. This is a very important concept in photography, and this is really where the rubber meets the road. If you understand this concept, and it takes some studying, that's why I wanted to do it in this video format. Follow this along with what I have written in the learning module for this week, and a little bit later in the week, we'll also have another one of those practice tests where I will give you some of these problems, and you can practice answering some of the questions according to the lessons that you've learned this week. So look it over carefully, play the video back if you need to, and study it very well. And then from here on, I promise things will be a little easier when you're going out to photograph. I think you're going to notice that you'll have a huge change in the creativeness of your photograph just by understanding equivalent exposure, depth of field, sharpness of motion, and how the shutter speeds and the apertures and the ISO settings make all of this happen. Go out and practice this with your camera. That's the nice thing about digital cameras. You can photograph and see your results right away. In my day, when I started out doing photography with film, I had to wait a while and make lots of notes because when I got the film back, I had to get the pictures in the right order and take a look at the things that I was trying to do to see if it was working out for what I thought was happening. So look things over carefully, read the content this week, do the practice test, and then go out and practice this with your camera. Take care.